Well, I think in terms of, I think we've already covered it, in the sense that if you look at how active the Howard government was in getting membership of the East Asia Summit, that it had its inaugural meeting, that was not easy. Alexander Downer had to work very hard to achieve that. That was not membership that you could have assumed. Equally, the fact that G20 leaders met the meeting, the fact that G20 leaders met for the first time in 2008 against the backdrop of the global financial crisis, that was not something we could have taken for granted. Indeed, I was in Washington at the time. There was an active debate going on inside the Bush administration about whether there would be a bringing together of the G20 leaders, or whether there would be a meeting of what was being termed the G13 or the G14. And I can assure you that in no one's calculation that I saw anywhere in Washington was Australia part of the G13 or G14, despite the fact that countries with considerably smaller economies than Australia would have been deemed to be part of the G13 or G14 for reasons of geographic distribution. And who would have represented our interests in the G20? The United States wouldn't have, Japan wouldn't have. I don't think anyone would have been able to speak for us. And the Rudd government argued very strongly for a convening of the G20. His voice obviously was not alone. And ultimately, President Bush decided on a meeting of the G20 leaders. So I think the diplomacy you saw, you refer to in the formation of APEC in 1989 and the early 90s, its development into a leaders forum, that sort of diplomacy has continued right through to today. In terms of our role in international disarmament discussions, negotiations, we continue to play a big role there. The Rudd government's initiative in putting together a group headed by former Foreign Minister Gareth Evans, which produced a landmark document which provided the backdrop to the big meeting in the UN in New York in, 2010, I think it was. And so we remain active in that space, but I think the real focus there is on non-proliferation efforts in respect of DPRK in Iran. I'm not going to disagree with my next minister, but I suppose if you come from you do think of the Indian Ocean. Yeah, if you come from Perth, and indeed if you look at where our big resource developments in northwest and western Australia are, they're on the Indian Ocean. You look at the emergence of India and its importance to Australia, I think it's reasonable to refer to the Indo-Pacific. It does define it in broader terms, and certainly presents a big challenge for us in a tight fiscal environment. Beyond that, I don't think there's much to say. Look, I would simply say that I'm not a fan of David Hicks either. I don't have sympathy for him. And I'll simply leave it at that. I'm not going to get involved in the debate about Guantanamo Bay. I understand what the Americans did in respect of Guantanamo Bay. I know a lot of people disagree with that, but so be it. Look, I made it very clear. I had two disclaimers. One was that I was here in my capacity as Secretary of the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, I have no intention whatsoever of addressing any questions that relate to my next job. I'll be there in a month's time, and I'm not even thinking about it at this point. Okay, first of all, in terms of developing our economic relationship, this week we're having our first serious discussions with the Indonesians on a comprehensive economic partnership. That was initiated by Prime Minister Gillard and President Yudhoyono a year or so ago. It is a sort of free trade agreement. I think it has a strategic importance beyond trade, and I'd like to think that we could give some priority to it in our negotiations. I think that's one part. Secondly, I think we as a country need to engage more with Indonesia economically. If you look at the economic relationship between the two countries, it sits well below the political relationship. Two-way investment is pretty small, and I think there's a real challenge there for the Australian private sector. Obviously, corruption and the regulatory environment presents real challenges for the Australian private sector going into Indonesia. But nonetheless, I think the long-term opportunities are really there. And those that are going to benefit in the long term are going to be those that get in first and are prepared to persevere. In terms of, you mentioned a poll in relation to Indonesia and attitudes in respect of China long-term defence-wise. I'd simply say that, and I'm not trying to be clever here, that we don't engage with Indonesia off the back of polls and the like. I think the Indonesian government would have a more nuanced view than that, which is reflected in the stark answer that you get to polling questions. We are off the back of the announcement last year about the 6-month rotational training in Australia by up to 2,500 Marines. Off the back of that, we've been talking. In fact, the Indonesians have raised with us the possibility of conducting some joint exercises, particularly in the area of disaster relief and humanitarian assistance, involving ourselves, Indonesia, and other members of the EAX, and that includes China. So I think they're thinking long term in terms of how to build more trust with China in the same way as we are. We have regular leaders' meetings between Australia and China. Every year, one of the top 5 or 6 Chinese leaders comes to Australia. However, if you look at the machinery we have at the top compared to what some other countries have with China, we do lag behind in an established leaders forum. Now, that's going to take some time to put together. China's going through a leadership transition, but I would like to think that over time we will establish such a mechanism. Foreign Minister Carr had discussions with the Chinese in July about it, and I was in China last week discussing the same thing. And I think over time we will get there. I can only, one that's obviously outside my area, but the ASIO, it's not that there's a prejudice against Tamils or any other group. ASIO apply the same criteria in their assessment of any individual in relation to a direct or indirect threat to security, and I can only assume that the representation of Tamils in that group represents a professional judgment by the professionals in ASIO. It's a fair while since our relationship with Indonesia was really bad, and I would make the broad comment that over the last 40, 50 years, the last 40 years anyway, when there has been points of real tension and real difficulties, the leadership of both countries have been able to step up to the mark and put the relationship first. I mean, historically, there has been a lot of suspicion amongst Australians of Indonesia. The Lowy poll has shown that up. And historically, there has been a good deal of suspicion amongst Indonesians of Australia, particularly our own attitudes and views in relation to the Eastern Archipelago. I think by and large, our leaders have put the relationship before popular prejudice. Indonesia will have democratic elections in 2014. One can only assume that those elections will be as credible and as free as what Indonesian presidential elections have been now for a little while. And that being the case, we don't get to choose who the leader of Indonesia is. Our job, our challenge, is to develop a constructive working relationship with whoever is there. And I think, ultimately, the sort of relationship we have with whoever is the next leader of Indonesia will be dictated by their own sense of national interest in respect of ourselves, and also our sense of national interest in respect of Indonesia. So I wouldn't overly exaggerate the importance of what particular views individuals might have in respect of Australia or vice versa. I refuse to entertain the latter thing. and in terms of confidence, I don't think, it's a bit like a football coach. Is it wise to express overconfidence before a grand final? What coach of any of the NRL or AFL teams this week are going to be out there today expressing a great deal of confidence? They will seek to be measured in what they say. It's no different when you're in any other conference, including for a seat on the UN Security Council. Benny's first comment was, have you got rocks in your head? And most people who have phoned me have opened with comments, what do you think you're doing, etc. But, why do you do anything? No one going into an organisation should seek to communicate with their future colleagues via the media in advance of getting there. That's just dumb. I will communicate with the media about defence after I'm in defence and I've had my feet well under the table for a while. my responsibility is to go to defence and communicate with people in defence before I communicate with people outside defence. In terms of the second question, the one you've just asked, it would be to give overseas students a sense of Australia and an experience of Australia. Overseas students, Australian universities are too fixated on making the buck out of the student. And I don't think they put enough time into thinking about the experience that the student has. Mr. Packer and Mr. Stokes obviously speak for themselves. I can't. Their motivation is their own. I'm not aware of us not being respectful in our relationship with China. In fact, I have no idea what it means to be more respectful. I'm not quite sure. What should I do? What should I walk differently, conduct myself differently, bow three times? I mean, what should I do? The government's relationships with China are always respectful. Leaders conduct themselves in a particular way. Ministers conduct themselves in a particular way. Senior officials do. It is not disrespectful to disagree with someone. You would certainly be disrespectful to your own country were you to consider that the views you have on particular issues could be bought. That would be disrespectful to yourself. And if you don't respect yourself, how do you respect others? So I think the starting point with respect resides in your own country and your own view of your own country. A very good question. Sanctions applied cleverly and in the right way can put pressure on people to respond more constructively. Sanctions applied bluntly and in the wrong way can sometimes drive people in the opposite direction to what you want. I think sanctions have played a role in bringing Iran back to the table. Where we go in terms of those discussions with Iran, I'm not sure, but I think the sanctions have played a role there. I think with the DPRK, it's been the cooperative work within the six-party talks, particularly between the US and China, which I think has exerted some influence on the DPRK. You might recall that there was a lot of speculation a few months ago about whether the DPRK, following its so-called satellite launch test, whether it might not also conduct another nuclear test. And there was a lot of commentary in the media expressing conviction that that would happen. It didn't, and I think China played a very important role in that. That wasn't sanctions, but it was certainly pressure. Syria, look, Syria is you know the equation there as well as I do. I mean, I think through sanctions, I think the global community has made it clear its view about the approach of the Syrian government, and certainly there's going to be a heavy price to pay over time by those individuals responsible. It may take a long time, but their day of reckoning will come. My own personal view, there is Papua and East Timor, and that is Indonesians have always considered that Papua was part of the Dutch East Indies, and Indonesia as the successor state of the Dutch East Indies. Papua was rightfully part of Indonesia. That's a view they have consistently held for decades. There are human rights abuses from time to time, and we do take them up with the Indonesians. We do indeed provide training to Indonesian forces, including to Detachment 88 of the National Police, which come under some criticism. And we do that because we judge that it's in our national interest. We judge that it's in our national interest because that detachment and others play a very important role in counter-terrorism. And we have a national interest in protecting the safety and lives of Australians in Indonesia. And therefore, we will continue to provide such support to elements of the Indonesian Armed Forces and their National Police. Look, I can't speak in how other departments conduct.
And yours?
Well, I don't believe we do. I mean, we don't have primitive IQ tests. That's just nonsense. You may call them primitive, but they're not. And we get 2,000 to 3,000 applications a year for this year recruiting 35 people. We're going to have a lot of disappointed people, and I've got no doubt that, like any recruitment process, I've got no doubt from time to time we make mistakes. I'm not aware of any recruitment process in the world that doesn't get it right. But we don't have crude tests, and we do take into account foreign languages. We do, and that is clear in terms of who we recruit. But simply because you've got a foreign language doesn't mean you've got good judgment, and it doesn't mean you've got the other attributes that we want in the department. Okay. I deliberately use the formal words I do in terms of punching up to our weight rather than punching above our weight. Australian governments are fond of talking about punching above our weight, and I think it's a pretty lazy way to think of your own country. If you convince yourself you punch above your weight, you're effectively saying in code word that, look, we do more than enough. We perform over and above what anyone else could expect. Code word for don't expect us to do any more. I think we should test ourselves, we should challenge ourselves. You know, individuals should challenge themselves, countries should challenge themselves. So I use the phrase I do deliberately as a challenge rather than necessarily as a deliberate criticism of any particular aspect of policy. It's a broad philosophical.
A general aspiration.
I think you've got to challenge yourself. If your starting point is we punch above our weight, well, where do you go? Presumably, what you do is go out the back, have a cup of tea, lie down, and take it easy for a couple of years. Whereas, if you question whether you punch up to your weight, perhaps you've got a little bit more thinking to do. Perhaps you've got other things to work on, etc. So it's that broad judgment. In terms of language, look, I can't comment in relation to specific universities, self-evidently, but I do stand by those comments for the Parliamentary Committee. We have seen still by far the most commonly spoken foreign language by people seeking to join our department is French. Now, I've got enormous respect for France. I've worked closely with several of their agencies. So this isn't an anti-French thing. It's just that, you know, it's a bit weird, given where we live, that you have all these French speakers, and we're going up backwards when it comes to Asian languages. And I think the white paper that's about to come out, I think we'll have a fair bit to say on that. What exactly it proposes and what exactly it will do, I'm not sure. But that is one of the areas where I can tell you we are punching below our weight, and we weren't helped when the monies that was allocated to promote Asian languages some years back were taken away under the Howard government. And that's not a criticism of it, it's just a statement of fact. With the United States, on some of the big issues coming down the track, such as climate change in response to climate change, I think there is a difference between us and the US. That's largely driven by the difficulty of getting an emissions trading scheme through the US Congress. And I don't see that being able to be achieved anytime soon. Although I was in the US on holidays in August, and I was quite struck, traveling around different parts, how the issue of climate change is very prominent in local newspapers, local radio, and in a fair bit of local discussion. For the first time this year, one nuclear reactor in the US had to be shut down because for the first time ever, the temperature of the seawater, which is used to cool the reactor, was too high, and they had to shut down the reactor. And that leads to a fair amount of local discussion and local attention. Some of the state governments in the US are doing different things, but I think it's going to be very difficult for the administration to get things through the Congress. That's a personal view. And therefore, I think there will continue to be some differences between us and the US on that. We, in respect of the US and China, we have a national interest in seeking, in whatever ways we can, to shape and influence US and Chinese attitudes. I mean, we in respect of the South China Sea, they're following the East Asia Summit senior officials meeting in Phnom Penh, where they or the ASEAN senior officials meeting and the like, where they failed to have a communique for the first time because of differences over the South China Sea, largely a result of pressure exerted by China on Cambodia. We developed our own proposal on that as to a possible way forward. We consulted with Indonesia and a few regional countries about that. We didn't consult with the US about it, but we put it to the US and others. So that doesn't reflect a difference with the US, it just reflects the fact that, we have 47% of all of Australia's merchandise trade and 57% of all of Australia's merchandise exports go through the South China Sea. We have an interest in anything that might upset the peace and stability of us in the South China Sea. So we think about that, and we take forward our own initiatives. Not a difference, but we do our own thing. With Indonesia, I think we have a different sort of relationship with Indonesia than what the US does. And there have been occasions when we have sought to encourage the US to adopt different approaches on certain matters. And indeed, following 9/11 and following Bali, we had some differences with the US about how to approach Indonesia. And finally, I might say that I think successive Australian governments have over time eventually convinced the US that Indonesia is a big, important country that ought to be taken more seriously than what they have historically done. I think that will be one of the issues that will be addressed in the white paper by Asian literacy. We don't mean simply being able to speak an Asian language. I think it's unrealistic to expect that every Australian is going to speak an Asian language. However, there are issues about knowledge of your neighbours, knowledge of key countries in the region. That can be part of history, can be part of geography, can be part of broader studies. I think that is one of the issues the white paper might have. Well, I don't see any difference between it being foreign-owned and Australian-owned. Whoever owns Cubby Station is going to have to abide by Australian laws because it's owned by foreign interests, doesn't exempt them from Australian laws. I mean, in 1982, 5.8% of Australian agricultural land was foreign-owned. And in 2012, foreign ownership of Australian agricultural land had exploded to about 6.1%. You know, we do need to have a bit of perspective here. I don't believe the AIIA link-ups will have an impact on foreign policy. Hopefully it will have an impact on our trading relationships with the countries of the Middle East and also people-to-people ties. I think we have about $6 or $7 billion trade with the Gulf states at the moment, which is pretty small given the given their size and ours. Hopefully, the switch up with the airlines will help there. But I think in terms of hard foreign policy interests, I doubt whether it will have much impact of itself. Although, if it does lead to growing trade and increased people ties, then that could have a flow on to foreign policy down the track. And I think, look, by the way, I think we do need to be careful in the use of the term Asian century. I think the term Asian century is a very good one, a very effective one, in terms of focusing public debate here in Australia about what's happening in the region and what it means for us. We do need, saying the bleeding obvious, but there is no such thing as an Asian century people are fond of talking about the last century as the American century. Well, I don't think anyone told the Americans that. The and certainly over the first 40 years of last century, I'm not quite sure whether he would have called it the American century. And of course, we are global. Our interests are global. We've got regional priorities. If you look at our trading investment patterns, if you look at people movements, you look at historical ties and the like, we have global interests. However, just as the Ghana report focused attention on Northeast Asia in 1989 and the early 90s, I think this white paper will highlight pathways and strategic directions in terms of what's happening in our region and what we need to do domestically to take advantage of that. And that's what I think the Treasurer was going to last week. It happened by accident. Most things happen by accident. I was studying at Sydney University on a teacher scholarship. For 3 years, my honours teacher was Neville Maney, Professor Neville Maney, and he said to me at the end of a third year, he said to me at the beginning of the honours year, he said, how are you looking forward to your debate next year, etc., etc. And I said, well, I don't know whether I want to be a teacher anymore. And he said, have you thought about external affairs as it then was? And literally, I said to him, what's that? And he explained it to me. I applied and I found myself there. I mean, I always had an interest in current affairs. I always had an interest in the world because I did geography and history at school and at university. And those two subjects do give you an interest in the wider world. So I had a natural starting point. I just didn't know anything about the institutional structure around our international relations with other countries. And when I applied for foreign affairs, I was talking to the brother-in-law of a university friend, also from Albury, and he said, what have you applied to foreign affairs for? I said, why? He said, you're a Catholic, you won't get in. That's true. And he said, I said, what do you mean? He said, well, Catholics go to customs or AGs. And that was news to me. And I discovered when I got into foreign affairs that two of the three people on the selection committee were Catholics. So, urban myths need to be treated with a bit of care. Often they're founded in reality at a point in time, but they develop into a myth and live on far beyond what's justified. And that's something else.